Your Honor, I have stood here for 3 months as one might stand at the ocean trying to sweep back the tide. I have heard in the last few weeks nothing but a cry for blood. I never saw such enthusiasm for the death penalty as I've seen here. It's been discussed as a holiday, like a day at the races. I've heard words from the state's attorney that would shame a savage. Mr. Crow suggests that if we hang these boys, there will be less killing. This world has been one long slaughterhouse from its beginning until today, and I have no doubt the killing will go on forever. Would hanging them make mankind better or worse? Would it make the human heart softer, or would it make it harder? If the state in which I live is not kinder, more humane, more intelligent than the mad act of these two boys, I am sorry I have lived so long. Why did they kill? Why did they kill Bobby Franks? Not for money. Not for spite. Not for hate. They killed him as they might kill a spider or a fly. For the experience. They killed him because they were made that way. They killed him because somewhere in the infinite processes that go into the making of the boy or the man, something slipped. Your Honor, I know that every atom in all the universe is bound together. I know that every influence, conscious and unconscious, acts and reacts on every living organism, and that no one can fix the blame. I do not know what made these boys do what they did, but I do know there is a reason for it. Why did they kill? We might also ask, why am I here defending them? Perhaps it's because of all the lives I have touched and have touched me that have formed my fate and brought me here to my destiny. All of these factors out of my control. You can't fight it, I know. Neither can Richard and Nathan. I'm sorry for Bobby Franks, and I'm sorry for his family. Mr. Crow suggests he would have been a man of promise. I do not know. Sometimes a boy of great promise is cut off in his youth. Sometimes he dies and is placed in a culvert. Sometimes a boy of great promise stands on a scaffold and is hanged by the neck until dead. Your Honor, I'm not asking for mercy here. What mercy is it to lock up two boys for life? Where is the human heart that will not be satisfied with that? If to hang these two boys would bring Bobby Franks back to life, I would say let them hang. If the welfare of this community would be benefited by the taking of their lives, well and good. But I wonder if it would do good. I wonder if it would help our children. Your Honor stands between the past and the future. You may hang these boys. You may hang them by the neck until they are dead. Today, it will be the easy and popular thing to do. The cruel and thoughtless will applaud. But others, the humane, the kind and hopeful, the mothers and fathers who are gaining an understanding and, asking questions not only about these poor boys, but about their own. They will join in no acclaim at the death of my clients. They would ask that the shedding of blood be stopped. I'm not pleading so much for these boys as I am for the infinite number of others to follow. It is of them I am thinking, and for them I am begging of this court not to turn backward toward the barbarous and cruel past. I plead for the future. I plead for a time when hatred and cruelty will not control the hearts of men. When with imagination and understanding and faith, we can look inside our own hearts and learn that all life is worth saving, and that mercy is the highest attribute of man. I was reading last night of the aspiration of the old Persian poet Omar Khayyam. It appealed to me as the highest that I can vision. I wish it was in my heart. I wish it was in all hearts. So I be written in the book of love. I do not care about that book above. Erase my name or write it as you will. So I be written in the book of love.
Richard Loeb and Nathan Leopold were sentenced to life in prison. The next summer, Father and Ruby went to Dayton, Tennessee for the Scopes Monkey Trial. The performance most everybody remembers him for. He took his agnosticism into the heart of the Bible Belt and made the case for teaching evolution in the schools. They didn't much care for him down there. One night, not long before he died, we got into a debate about God and the afterlife, and to settle it, he made this funny bet. He said that if there were life after death, he would come down to this very place on the anniversary of his death and apologize for his lack of faith. It's been 10 years now and still no sign of him. Not that I would ever expect him to show. Even if he could, he'd never admit he was wrong.